Hello and welcome to our video about SONiC and Containerlab. My name is Adam Kułagowski and I work as a network engineer at CodiLime. Today, during this presentation, I will start with an introduction about network automation, why it's so important nowadays, and what are the benefits here. After that, I will cover, although briefly, the Containerlab and SONiC, as both of them play a major role in that area. Then, I will talk about how to deploy a fully working SONiC device in Containerlab. I will finish by showing a brief demo containing all those above parts. So, without any further ado, let's begin. The exponential growth of devices, the increasing demand of bandwidth, and the emergence of new technologies like cloud computing, IoT, has made manual network management difficult, if not obsolete. Needless to say, there are several advantages of network automation. Enhanced efficiency, automation, reduced manual intervention, so tasks that once took hours or days now can be accomplished in minutes. Improved reliability. Automated processes minimize human errors, resulting in more stable and reliable network environment. Also, consistency in configuration leads to fewer issues and better performance. Then we have faster troubleshooting. Automation tools provide real-time monitoring and alerting, enable quick identification and resolution of network issues. We can collect network state before a change is made and compare it to the network state after a change was performed. Any differences, such as different number of prefixes, will alert us immediately that something went wrong. Last but not least, cost saving. By reducing manual labor, network automation tools contribute to cost saving in terms of time, resources, and operational expenses. A crucial part of network automation is digital twin. A digital twin at its heart is either a full mirror or at least a good model of production network that will be used as a testbed for our planned network or configuration changes, or a place when we can test our scripts before they will be used in production environment. There are several types of digital twins. Let's start with physical ones, when dedicated physical router, switches, and other devices are used. This approach is great when you need identical environment down to ASIC behavior. However, this approach is expensive, not flexible. Let's mention the need of physical recabling each time alone and takes a lot of space and power. Then we have virtual machine-based twins. We can emulate here a real device behavior, as many device vendors emulate data plane in their virtual machines. Having that, the next advantage here is that we have much higher flexibility, as everything can be launched just using a few rack servers, since everything is virtualized. However, larger scales, over 100 devices, still require a lot of resources, as VM virtual machines are heavy in their nature. Also, the open source tools, such as DNS-free or EVNG, has pure automation support, making it difficult to include them in automated processes such as CI/CD. At the end, we have container-based twins. If we care little for data plane and we want to concentrate on management and control planes, while keeping resources usage low, this would be the right path for us. The more popular virtual environment for container-based devices is a container lab. So a container lab is a newest member of virtual network software. It concentrates on containers rather on VMs. The topologies are very portable. The whole environment can be defined as a single YAML file. This approach creates huge possibilities for automation. With a touch of few bash scripts, one can easily create a lab hosting hundreds of nodes. And the result, and the best of all, it can be run on a simple laptop with 16 gigabytes of RAM. Even more, as there is a Docker under it, when the device image is missing, it will be automatically downloaded either from the Docker Hub when the image is public or from a private repository. As each device can be configured upon its deployment, with a single command, one can have a full topology running in no time. Since the container lab is using Dockers, the images itself are very light. For example, the topology shown on this slide with 15 devices, each running OSPF, SNMP, LLDP. This whole topology takes 3 GB of RAM and can be deployed under a single minute, again using an average laptop CPU. As soon as you deploy the topology, you can SNMP to query each device for the OSPF neighbors, LLDP agency. So it's ideal for network monitoring software and CI/CD integration. With large topology and your fingerprints, one can start working with a big topology, typical issues or features such as BGP advanced routing policy, MPLS segment routing, telemetry and traffic sample, and of course others. Scalability is one of the ContainerLab major advantages. The other one is flexibility. Again, thanks for the Docker nature, the possibilities here are endless. For example, on the previous slide, I mentioned OSPF, LLDP, and SNMP. Sure, we can create a Docker super image that will combine FRR, SNMP daemon, and LLDP daemon, and others, but this approach is worrisome. What we can do instead, we can use a native Docker functionality called shared network spaces. In short, we can launch several containers that are sharing the same interfaces, routing tables, and whole network stack. So we take popular images from the Docker stack hub, no need to build them locally, stack them on top of each other, and we can call it a day. Simple, fast, efficient. ContainerLab also addresses a thing that I personally missed in the Docker or Docker Compose. When deploying a container, by default, one is limited to a single command that is launched inside, the Docker entry point. Yes, you can edit that entry point and rebuild that image, or you can use a Docker exec command for each container deployed, but this doesn't feel native. With ContainerLab, there are several hooks that can be triggered during lab deployment on different phases, and those hooks can be launched either inside or outside of the container. So if you want to launch a custom commands or commands plural, ContainerLab have you covered here as well. As you can see, the software itself is great, it's flexible, it scales nicely. However, when it comes to the device images, things are a bit worse here. Let's talk about the SONiC. Before mentioning SONiC, let's bring a bigger picture first. Today, when dealing with a large networks, it means dealing with networks that are often heterogeneous in both of terms of hardware and the software. Yes, one can go with a single vendor approach, but at the cost of a vendor locking, in terms of the price and in terms of security issues that are affecting whole parts of the network at once. So this approach is rare. On the other cases, when there is more than one network in topology, we often see a lack of unification in the management tools or the environment. With a SONiC, we can mitigate this problem by having a different hardware providers using the same operating system on each device. So one can say that the SONiC continues the work idea, but not the code, of the Cumulus Linux before it was purchased by the NVIDIA. Also, SONiC is an open source, at least the non-SAI part, and operates on Linux, here Debian, so it should be easily integrated into ContainerLab. That being said, the reality is not so nice. After first deployment of containerized SONiC, one can quickly find that there are several limitations in play. Most importantly, several commands does not work at all. They either use sudo, which is not included, or use docker exec, which is not included as well. So issuing those commands results in command not found output. This is not expected, of course. Also, there is no LLDP. It does make sense with a single Docker deployment, but we would like to have this feature working in ContainerLab while topologies are bigger. Also, the FRR components responsible for routing is also broken, making advanced routing feature impossible. And last but not least, since internal Docker are missing, as well as systemd, the internal architecture of the SONiC is totally different than one would expect after having some experiences with physical devices. To sum it up, the Docker version, which is the only version currently supported in SONiC in ContainerLab, is significantly restricted up to the point of being broken beyond any repair. It doesn't mean that one cannot get full SONiC experience in ContainerLab. It just means that the road to that point will be a bit longer than one would expect in the first place. So in order to reach that point, we should deploy SONiC as a virtual machine in ContainerLab. VMs in ContainerLab are treated a bit differently, but on the outside there are also a container. In other words, a VM device in ContainerLab is a Docker with a KVM inside, along with a launch script and some connectivity magic to attach VM to a ContainerLab network. To make things easier, there's a dedicated repository called VRNetLab, dedicated for hosting VMs inside Dockers. There are several VMs supported already, such as Nokia, Arista, Cisco Juniper. The list is already long. ContainerLab uses a fork of that repository in order to keep VM integration as smooth as possible. Having all that said, let's go into details how we can integrate SONiC VM into the ContainerLab. First, let's take a look at the VM inside the Docker of the architecture. On the left diagram, you can see Docker with VETH interfaces along with a VM launched via the KVM. The interfaces between VM and the Docker are connected using Linux TC, which stands for Linux Advanced Traffic Control. Although using a TC might seem a strange way to connect interfaces, the authors of Container Labs tried all the obvious approaches such as Linux Bridge, Linux Max VTAP, or VS. And each of those approaches had some drawbacks, such as dropping LACP packets, the need of install external components such as OVS, and so on. So the TCAP approach with its action mirrored packet was working flawlessly from the start, and hence it was used here. We must also keep in mind that the first interface of the VM is being treated differently. The first interface assumed to be a management interface, and instead of using TC, we are using a net user type of interface. This means that there will be a port NAT between a VM and the rest of the management network in play. The default ports for NAT, SSH, console, SNMP, WebUI should be enough for our needs. However, there is a catch here. In order to use NAT, we need to configure an IP address inside that VM. Ideally, we should have a possibility to apply a full configuration as well when the VM finishes booting up. So the only way to configure an IP address inside of the VM, regardless of the VM type, so we cannot assume that there will be DHCP, API, ZTP, is to use a console. So the entry point of our Docker with a SONiC should be doing four things. First, launch a VM. Second, bind VETH interfaces and virtio interfaces altogether. Third, attach itself to a VM console and wait for the prompt to appear. As soon as the VM finishes booting up, our script uses that prompt to set up an IP address and credential for SSH. And last, having that, the entry point should copy and override full SONiC configuration using SCP between shared docker and volume and the etc config directory inside SONiC VM. If all those steps go smoothly, we should have a fully configured and running a SONiC image inside ContainerLab. So at this point, you know how to create a new VM inside ContainerLab, know how to configure it, know how everything works together. I pushed the work into the ContainerLab repo in hope that the script will become an integral part of ContainerLabs, and it already happened as our pull request has been merged. Let's put everything together. So in order to launch a SONiC, we must install a ContainerLab, obviously, download a SONiC image that will be used later on, copy that image into the proper directory of cloned VRNAT lab repository, build a Docker image. A simple make command will do. Optionally, we can push the Docker image into the registry so we won't have to redo those steps each time. And then we can deploy a container lab topology. Sounds simple, and in our demo, I will show that this indeed is the case. I'm slowly coming to the end of our video, and the demo is the last part of it. Before I start our demo, let's talk briefly about the topology. Here we have a topology with five devices. On top we have a SONiC device, on left we have FRR, and on the right we have FRR as well. Those devices are connected with the BGP peering and with the family init, of course. We could use a different families, but we wanted to keep things simple. Each FRR advertised towards SONiC D networks, allowing the routing to exist and work fluently. In our demo, in our steps, I will build a SONiC Docker with VM inside, deploy everything, and perform a trace route between PC1 and PC2 endpoints to show that the SONiC device is routing packets as expected. So without any further ado, let's switch to the terminal and go with the demo. So let's first build an image from the that we talked about earlier. Let's go to the directory. Let's check if the qcow is there. Yes, it is. So let's issue a make. Okay, let's check if the Docker image was created. This was indeed the case. So let's switch to the directory when the container of topology exists. Let's deploy the whole environment. Let's check how the SONiC device is booting up. It's a VM, so it's taking a little bit longer than the container, obviously, but it should be pretty fast. You can see that our script has intercepted the console, has set an IP address on the first interface, set the password for the admin, so it should be fine. Now let's log into the SONiC device. The password is admin. And let's check if the BGP neighbors are up. It's still booting up, so let's wait a little bit longer. And there they are. As right now they are in idle state, but we can see FRR1 and FRR2. And yep, they are connected. They are up and running. They have two prefixes, so everything is expected and okay here. So now let's attempt to do a trace route between PC1 and PC2. So let's go into the PC1 Docker. Let's issue an MTR here, and we can see here that we have four hops. The first one is the first FRR, SONiC device itself, second FRR, and the target endpoint. So this concludes the demo. We can exit the Docker. We can save the configuration, the whole topology before we destroy it. And let's destroy the topology. Okay, so this concludes our demo. I hope you find this video interesting. Please leave the comment under the YouTube video. Thanks for the watching.